السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا مولانا رسول الله وآله وصحبه من والاه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وبعد, dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, today inshallah ta'ala we're going to discuss the main lessons in juz number 13 inshallah ta'ala. And before I start my lecture tonight, I would like to give you one very important reminder about Zakatul Fitr. A lot of people now are asking, how can I pay Zakatul Fitr? Because we know that we have to pay Zakatul Fitr for our Siyam to be accepted inshallah azza wa jal. What you can do is you can go to the masjid to drive through to the Islamic Association of Saskatchewan, or masjid in Montague Street inshallah ta'ala, on Wednesday tomorrow at 5 p.m. and also on Sundays at 3 p.m. So please, if you want to pay your Zakatul Fitr, you have to go to the masjid, drive through by yourself to drop your Zakatul al-Fitr, and it has to be at 5 p.m. on Wednesdays and 3 p.m. on Sundays. Please spread the word and tell people, because a lot of people are asking. That's the only way that we receive the Zakatul Fitr this year inshallah ta'ala. And also do not forget to pay some of your donations to the food bank. A lot of people nowadays are in need, and some people don't even have food to eat, and that's a good way to do da'wah to the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal by donating some money to the food bank inshallah ta'ala. So after these two brief reminders, we're going now to start with our alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh everyone. We're going to start with our lecture tonight on juz number 13 to learn the same or the main lessons that Allah Azza wa Jal has to tell us in this juz. So the first lesson that we're having tonight, inshallah ta'ala, is yesterday we started talking about the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi wa ala nabiyyina salatu wassalam. And we said when we talk about the story of Prophet Yusuf, we always remember what Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the first three ayat in the surah, of the surah, when he said, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. Ya Muhammad, we are narrating to you the best of stories ever, which is the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi wa nabiyyina salatu wassalam. You know, it's better than movies that people like, better than the stories like Harry Potter, for example. You know, we watch movies sometimes because of the story. The story is interesting, and that's why I like to watch it. But you know what? If the movie doesn't have a point at the end, a message for us, I feel that I have wasted 1.5 hours, or I wasted 2 hours of my time just watching a movie or watching a story if there's no point at the end. But the main reason why the stories of the Quran are the best of stories ever, because there's a point, there's a lesson at the end. There is something, a message that I can learn from the stories of the Quran. And that's what Allah Azza wa Jal, yes, Zakatul Fitr is $10. Yes, I didn't mention how much, it's $10 inshallah ta'ala this year as well for Saskatchewan. For Saskatchewan. So yes, أحسن الله, can learn a lot of lessons from the stories of the Quran. Let's now go and see the rest of the lessons that we have in the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, or in the part that's mentioned in juz number 13. Because yesterday we discussed some of the lessons from Prophet Yusuf's story that's mentioned in juz number 12. Today in juz number 13 we have the other part of surah of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, and surah Yusuf also mentioned in juz number 13. So the first thing that we have here is suppressing outrage. Suppressing our anger is something that's really praiseworthy in Islam. Just the fact that I can see something, or I can hear something that makes me very agitated, or I can be in a situation which is, it can be at the masjid, it can be with my family, it can be at work, it can be at school, and I go through something, or I hear something, or something happens to me, or I hear some people talking about me in a certain way, and I feel very angry. But I'm able to control myself and to suppress this anger and this outrage. That is something that's really is praiseworthy in Islam, and Allah loves this so much. And that's actually one of the main things that we learn from fasting, is to be able to control and suppress our outrage, and to be able to suppress and control our anger. That's very important. When can I find this in Surah Yusuf alayhi as-salatu wassalam? You can find this in verse number 77. When the brothers of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, they were talking to him when he was the king in Egypt, and they were describing to him about brother Benjamin, that he was accused of stealing. They said to the king, who is Yusuf in this case, and they don't recognize Yusuf alayhi salam to be their brother. And they said to him, if Benjamin had stolen something, or if he stole something, actually his brother has done the same thing in the past, talking about Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So the brothers are talking to the king, who is Yusuf, without recognizing him, and telling him that Benjamin's brother has also stolen something in the past. Imagine that's being said about you, to your face, in your presence, and people are accusing you of something that you haven't done. Because Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam was accused falsely of stealing when he was young, alayhi salatu wassalam. If you go to verse 77 in Surah Yusuf, and Surah Yusuf is chapter 12, verse 77, Allah Azza wa Jal says about the brothers of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam to distance themselves, to make themselves innocent. They said, they argued and they said to the king, who is Yusuf alayhi salam, if Benjamin has stolen, so did his full brother before, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam. How did Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam react to this difficult situation? He was accused of something by the closest people to him, his brothers, his blood relatives, his brothers, to his face, and it's a lie. How did he respond? قال الله فأسرها يوسف في نفسه ولم يبدها لهم. But Yusuf alayhi salam suppressed his outrage. He was able to suppress his outrage. Why did Allah mention this in the Quran, when somebody is able to suppress his anger? Because it's something really difficult to be able to suppress your anger when you're so angry and you want to explode and say something in return to that person who's accusing you of something false to your face, and he doesn't know that he's accusing you to you. So to control that, that's actually very difficult. And that's why Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned it in the Quran for us to reflect and to act accordingly. Yusuf alayhi salam suppressed his outrage, revealing nothing to them. He never mentioned anything to them. So just being able to do that is something really extremely difficult and praiseworthy in Islam. The other lesson that we can take from the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam is avoiding the evil eye is from Islam. Avoiding the evil eye is from Islam. Some people, when they see us talking about the evil eye, or not talking about our blessings in front of people who don't have the same blessings, or not talking about our goals so much before we achieve our goals, because we might get harmed, we might get envied. Some people might envy us if they are bad people. When we talk about this, some people don't believe in this, and they keep telling us, you're just imagining people. That doesn't exist. Actually, that exists. We find this in the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, and in the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know Rasulullah said what? He said, Al-aynu haqq. He said, the evil eye is truth. The evil eye is the truth. Al-aynu haqq. And then he said, Adkhalat al-rajula al-qabr. Sometimes if somebody looks at someone else, if he has a lot of blessings, Allah has given him a lot of blessings, and he might envy him until he dies. And Nabi Asam, he said, أَدْخَلَتِ الرَّجُلَ الْقَبْرِ. That person can be envied until he dies and he is buried in the grave. الرَّجُل will enter into the grave and be buried because of the evil eye. And then he said, وَأَدْخَلَتِ الْجَمَلِ الْقِدْرِ. Rasulullah is giving people an example from the environment where they used to live, and the animals and the creatures, or the creation of Allah that they used to interact with, which is the camels in this case. He said, وَالْجَمَلَ الْقِدْرِ. Someone might look at a camel at the time of the Arabs, and the camel is, mashallah, massive, and it has a lot of meat, and it's strong, and it looks beautiful and clean, and it's eating so much. that person can, if he's evil, he can give an evil eye to the camel until the camel is slaughtered and it will be put in the pot to be cooked. وَأَدْخَلَتِ الْجَمَلَ الْقِدْرِ So the evil eye can kill a human being. It can kill an animal. So don't talk about your blessings a lot in front of people. But at the same time, do not exaggerate. Do not exaggerate. Do not do this too much, because otherwise it's going to turn into a waswas. You put your trust in Allah Azza wa Jal, and when you try to achieve something, just hide it until you achieve it. Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salatu wassalam, that's what he told his sons. He said, وَقَالَ يَا بَنِيَّ O my sons, لَا تَدُخُلُوا مِن بَابٍ وَاحِدٍ Do not enter the city through one gate. Don't do that. You know, he told them to divide themselves into three, every three or four, go through one gate. Don't go all together through one gate. وَدُخُلُوا مِنْ أَبْوَابٍ مُتَفَرِّقَةٍ But enter through separate gates, because they might be envied, they might be harmed. Next point is having good thoughts about Allah Azza wa Jal is the outcome of having knowledge of who Allah is, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we always talk about having good thoughts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in the middle of the most difficult situations. That's one of the most important qualities that every believer has to have. And I said this before, and I'm going to repeat it again. And I will continue to see the same thing, even in the midst of this pandemic. Wallahi al-azim, there's a lot of khair for us. You just sit down and reflect on the blessings of Allah Azza wa Jalla that you have. How much time do we have? How much time that we have to read books? How much time do we have to educate ourselves? How much time do we have to volunteer? How much time do we have to sit down with our families? How much time do we have to call our relatives back home? How much time do we have nowadays to achieve a lot of amazing things? These are some of the benefits that we have through this pandemic. So through every difficult situation, have good thoughts of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and that only comes as an outcome of our knowledge of who Allah is. Look what Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salam, when he missed Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, and after that he missed him, and then, I mean, he lost him, he lost Prophet Yusuf, and then he lost his brother Benjamin alayhi salam. And then the rest of his sons came back to him and he lost both of them. What did he say? Look what he said. قَالَ بَلْ سَوَّلَتْ لَكُمْ أَنفُسُكُمْ أَمْرًا He said, no, your souls must have tempted you to do something evil. You have done it yourself. You lost Yusuf and then his brother intentionally. You know for how long he lost the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam? Some narration said for 40 years. For 40 years. Sometimes we're having a hard time that we're away from our families for 10 years, for 20 years, for 30 years. You know what? We came here intentionally. But Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam was separated from his families unintentionally. He was forced to leave his family alayhi salatu wasalam. Imagine being forced to leave your family for 40 years and being accused with your brothers. And imagine you're the father and you know that your sons or your children, they plotted against one of your sons, and they lost him intentionally. What did he say? He said, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ The only thing that I'm left with is to have beautiful patience. And beautiful patience meaning to endure patience without complaining to people. But I can complain to Allah Azza wa Jal. Don't complain about Allah to people. Don't ever do that. That is haram. You complain to Allah Azza wa Jal at night, sit down with Allah Azza wa Jal and talk to him and complain to him. Huh? He said, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ The only thing that I'm left with is صَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ Beautiful patience. And then he said what? Look at the beautiful thoughts, the good thoughts about Allah. عَسَى اللَّهُ أَن يَأْتِيَنِي بِهِمْ جَمِيعًا I trust Allah that He will return them all to me. I trust that Allah is going to return Yusuf and Benjamin, and this happened at the end of the story because of his trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. Put your trust in Allah Azza wa Jal through any difficult situation. Next lesson that we have from the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, being thankful to Allah because every blessing is only from Him. We talked yesterday about some people are rich, some people are poor, some people are healthy, some people are unhealthy, and Allah Azza wa Jalla created the world this way. He designed His world this way to test people. This life is not a game. This life is a test. We have rich people and we have poor people. So Allah now is testing those rich people. Are you going to be thankful to Allah Azza wa Jalla by checking out on the poor people and donating and helping them? And also he's testing the poor. Are you going to get up and do what you're supposed to do and take the actions and apply the means, الأخذ بالأسباب, to be able to have more provision and to be even richer? Are you going to do this, both of you? So it's a test. Life is a test. But you know what? At the end of the day, if I have a lot of blessings, somebody has a lot of money, he is healthy, he has good relation with people, community members love him, he has amazing children, you have, at the end of the day, to attribute all what you have from blessings only to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's not because of me, it's not because I work overtime, it's not because I have a lot of energy, it's not because I'm young and have a lot of energy that I can work overtime, it's not because of that. It's not because I have a lot of qualifications and I have a lot of knowledge in this field other than people in the same field. No, it's not because of that. It's only, wallahi, because of Allah Azza wa Jal. Just, you need to absorb this lesson. Everything is only from Allah Azza wa Jal. Where can we learn this from the Surah Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam? At the end of his story, after Allah Azza wa Jal reunited him with his family and his parents and his brothers, and they all acknowledged his favors on them, he said, Rabbi qad ataytani min al-mulk. Oh my Lord, you have surely, you Allah, have surely granted me authority. I have authority, any kind of authority. It's not because of me. It's not because of people love me and they voted for me. It's not because I'm strong that I could get this authority with my money, for example, bribing people. It's not about that. It's Allah gave you this authority as a test, or because you're qualified to take this authority. Maybe you're so qualified and Allah knows you're going to be beneficial to your community, to your city, to your province, to your country. Or maybe you're not as qualified, but it's a test for you. Allah wants to see what you're going to do, right? So Sayyidina Yusuf said, رَبِّ قَدْ آتَيْتَنِي مِنَ الْمُلْكِ. This authority, Ya Rabb, is from you. وَعَلَّمْتَنِي مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ. You taught me the interpretation of dreams. So it's not because of me, I have a lot of qualifications. No. Allah Azza wa Jal taught us. Azza wa Jal. The next lesson that we have in Surah Yusuf alayhi salam, it's actually in Surah Ra'd. We're now going to go to Surah Ra'd in Juz number 13. There are 10 qualities that Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned, and I please encourage you after this talk to go open the Mus'haf Surah Ar-Ra'd from verse 19 to verse 22. From verse 19 to verse 22. And read these ayat. If you don't know in Arabic, read them in English. Read the translation. Maybe if you can see some tafsir online or something, like the Tafsir Ibn Kathir or the Clear Quran that I recommended before. Just reflect on these ayat from ayah number 19 to ayah number 22 in Surah Ar-Ra'd. They will tell you 10 qualities of people who reason, and reflect, and they will be able to make it to eternity in paradise, inshallah. May Allah make us amongst those people. Of course, we don't have time to explain them or to elaborate on all of them. I'm just gonna mention them one after one and maybe give a very brief clarification, and then inshallah ta'ala, I'm requesting you to go back to your mushaf, to your tafsir, Surah Ar-Ra'd 19 to 22, to reflect what are the 10 qualities that Allah wants me to implement in my life, for me and my family, to be able to reach eternity in paradise, inshallah ta'ala. Allah says, أَفَمَنْ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ الْحَقُّ كَمَنْ هُوَ أَعْمَى إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. The first thing that the people who reflect do is that يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. يَعْلَمُ أَنَّمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ الْحَقُّ. The first thing is يَعْلَمُ أَنَّمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ الْحَقُّ كَمَنْ هُوَ أَعْمَى. So the first quality is knowing that Allah's revelation is the absolute truth. Allah Azza wa Jal's revelation is the absolute truth. Even if something else makes more sense to me, and some ayah or hadith doesn't make a lot of sense because of my lack of understanding, again, I need to put my trust in the book of Allah and His revelation. It's the absolute truth. Even if it doesn't make sense, it may be because of my lack of understanding, my lack of knowledge. I need to ask, I need to make my research. Number one, to put your trust that Allah's revelation is the absolute truth. Number two, to honor Allah's covenant and to never break your pledge with Allah. These are two different words, and I've received a message to elaborate a little bit on the difference between الَّذِينَ يُفُونَ بِعَهْدِ الله ولا ينقضون الميثاق. These two words, عهد and ميثاق. عهد and ميثاق. What is the difference between عهد and ميثاق? I'm gonna elaborate on this a little bit because some people ask me this question online. عهد is a promise. عهد is a covenant. When you promise someone something, that's called عهد. And Allah said here, عهد الله. عهد الله. Those who fulfill Allah's promise. To make it even more important, عهد Allah Azza wa Jal. What is the Allah's promise? What is the covenant that we're having with Allah Azza wa Jal? Is to obey Him, to avoid what is haram. You know what? Even if we don't fulfill our covenant with Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah is going to fulfill what He told us because of His mercy. He is so merciful. Just fulfill Allah's covenant, He is going to respond in a positive way. And even if I make mistakes and I break my covenant with Allah Azza wa Jal, but I repent, Allah is going to fulfill His promise to me. عهد الله. طيب. ولا ينقضون الميثاق. Sometimes we find these two words are translated the same. عهد is promise and ميثاق is also promise. ميثاق is a pledge. So what is the difference between عهد and ميثاق? The main difference, I'm not gonna explain a lot. The main difference is عهد is a promise. ميثاق is a promise that's confirmed by an oath. That's it. So عهد is a promise, covenant, but ميثاق is a promise that's confirmed by an oath, so it's even more stronger. Number four, to maintain whatever ties Allah has ordered to be maintained. Please make sure that you call your families every single day and you call your relatives in the occasions and don't cut your relations with your relatives because that's one of the things that Allah Azza wa Jal ordered us to maintain. Ar-Rahim comes from one of Allah's names, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Don't even cut your relations with your relatives. Number five, to stand in awe of Allah Azza wa Jal. Number six, to fear the judgment day. And I'm going now to talk about two very interesting situations that are going to happen in the day of judgment. The first one is the khutbah of the shaitan. And the second one is how Allah fulfills our promises on day of qiyamah. So that's interesting. Number seven, to endure patiently for Allah's sake. Number eight, to establish prayers. And again, to have patience came before establishing prayers. Because you won't be able to establish prayers or even fast or pay zakah or do whatever obligation you have or to study or to go to work unless you have patience first. Number nine, to donate from what Allah has provided for you. If you want Allah to make your life easier, just go donate. If you want to be happier, go make people happy. If you want Allah to make you smile, go make other people smile. You know, subhanallah. It's so difficult to even absorb the idea that some people in the world don't have iftar. They don't have food to break their fast nowadays around the world. I'm not only talking about our city here. Even though we're having our food hamper drive and we're having our own projects of the collecting donations and providing for people who don't have who are less fortunate, but there are people around the world they don't have even food to eat. Like imagine if you go to work during the day and you're so exhausted and you're just waiting for Maghrib to Allahu Akbar or the time to come to eat. There are people, it doesn't matter how long they wait, they don't have something to eat. That's very difficult to even absorb this idea. Alhamdulillah, we need to thank Allah a lot for being that fortunate in this part of the world. Relatively, we're one of the most blessed Muslim minorities in the world. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Number 10, the last one, to respond to the evil with good, which is one of the difficult qualities. But as I told you, please go back to Surah Ar-Ra'd and reflect on these ones with your family. Last two points that I'm going to mention. The second last point is the shaitan's khutbah. Shaitan's khutbah. It even sounds funny. Does the shaitan give khutbahs? Yes, he does. The shaitan give khutbahs. And he will stand up on the day of Qiyamah and address the audience. Who are the audience of the shaitan? The audience of the shaitan are people who used to follow him in this dunya. Allah Azza wa Jalla told us in Surah Al-Baqarah, He told us in Surah Al-Imran, that the shaitan, Ya Rabbi Surah Al-A'raf, that shaitan is our main enemy. You need to be very careful. And I don't know if you remember or not, one of his most dangerous tricks is indecencies. That's what he did with Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam and his wife when he caused them to be exposed and exposed their nakedness, right? So if you don't avoid the shaitan and disobey him, on the day of Qiyamah, he's going to give you a khutbah. I mean, not you. He's going to give people who obeyed him a khutbah. What is this khutbah? Allah said, وَقَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَمَّا قُضِيَ الْأَمْرِ. And Satan, shaitan, will say to his followers, after the judgment has been passed, خلاص, everything is over, Allah Azza wa Jalla has given his decision, some people are going to go to Jannah, some people are going to go to hellfire. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us amongst people who go to Jannah. Allahumma amin ya Rabbil Alameen. And again, this is my right. Even though you see it in the camera as if it's my left. No, this is my right side, Jannah, and this is my left side, hellfire. May Allah make us from the people of the right side. Allahumma amin ya Rabbil Alameen. What is he going to say? إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَكُمْ وَعَدَ الْحَقِّ. Allah Azza wa Jalla, indeed, Allah has made you a true promise. Allah has made you a true promise. What is the promise of Allah Azza wa Jal? Do what I told you to do, you're going to make it to Jannah. Avoid the haram, that's the what's going to make you amongst the awliya. Just avoiding the haram. As we said yesterday, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Allah described awliya. Have iman, belief, and avoid haram things. Right? Allah said, that's my promise. طيب. إن الله وعدكم وعد الحق. Shaitan said, ووعدتكم فأخلفتكم. I too made you a promise, but I failed you. I also made you a promise, but I failed you. Oh yeah, you know, إلا تكون ملكين أو تكون من الخالدين. He told Sayyidina Adam عليه الصلاة والسلام, if you eat from the tree, you're gonna turn into an angel, and this doesn't happen. You're gonna have eternity in the Jannah if you eat from the tree, and تكون من الخالدين. He didn't have it. Same thing in this dunya. Shaitan comes to you and tells you, for example, to cheat, or for example, in business, or to backbite some people because you have this joy for a little bit of time, or you have a little bit of more time in this world. You know, a lot of promises, and all these are fake. He said, you're played. In the day of Qiyamah, he will tell those people who used to obey him, you're played, you know. وَوَعَدْتُكُمْ فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ. And I failed you. And look at this. وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ. Look at this guy. I did not have any authority over you. I did not have any authority. I did not force you. Look, this is one of the ayat. This is one of the ayat that we need to tell our youth and even ourselves before our youth, that it's a clear evidence that we have an absolute free will in what we do and what we don't do. وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ. Shaitan pushed me to do this. No, the Shaitan didn't push you to do anything. He said, وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ. I didn't have any authority on you. إِلَّا except أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي. دَعَوْتُكُمْ, I invited you. دَعْوَة is to invite someone. دَعْوَة, right? I invited you and you accepted. That's what he did. He did not control me. He did not control my body. He did not control my actions, as some people imagine. No. He only whispered. He only invited me and I obeyed. إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي. Then he's going to say, فَلَا تَلُومُونِي. Don't blame me for your mistakes. وَلُومُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Only blame yourselves. Just blame yourselves. مَا أَنَا بِمُصْرِخِكُمْ. I cannot save you. Nor can you save me. خلاص, we're both are going to be tortured. May Allah protect us. إني كفرت. يا سبحان الله. He's believing now. The shaitan is converting now. He's becoming a Muslim. He said, فلا ما أنا إني كفرت بما أشركتموني من قبل. I'm a kafir now of your shirk with Allah عز وجل. I'm a kafir. I'm innocent. I'm away from all what you've done in this dunya. Indeed, I denounce your previous association of me with Allah in loyalty. Now I'm a Muslim. إني كفرت بما إن الظالمين لهم عذاب شديد. Surely the wrongdoers will suffer painful punishment. That's shaitan. So what the shaitan did here is what? He failed us, right? That's the last point is here. Shaitan failed us. That's the second last point. The last point is Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to fulfill His promise. Go to Surah Ibrahim, Ayah 47. Allah says, فَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ مُخْلِفَ وَعَدِهِ رُسُولَهُ. So do not ever think, O Prophet, that Allah will fail to keep His promise to His messengers. So Shaitan breaks His promises. So breaking, what we can learn from this, breaking is one of the attributes of the shaitan. Huh? Fulfilling my promise is one of the most beloved actions to Allah Azza wa Jal. and also fulfilling my contracts is included in this concept. After this, I'm just gonna go very fast through some of your questions if you have any, and give very brief comments. Inshallah ta'ala. Yes, Zakat al-Fitr is $10, inshallah azza wa jal. منور يا محمد زبيك يا ابو يوسف انت اللي منور بارك الله فيك ومس يو Yes, Sister Shalin, if you missed the number 6 and number 7, go to Surah Al-Ra'd, Surah Al-Ra'd, verse 19-22. And you will find the 10 attributes that I mentioned. Na'mana can share the mudia she mentioned here. Brother Muhammad Rahman. Oh yeah, he said yesterday was a printing mistake. It's fine. I just read what I have in front of me, you know. I don't have time to analyze, just read what I have. It's a life. Mistake of my no problem. My original question was whether can we recite Ayatul Kursi without wudu? Can we make dhikr of Allah? Yeah. Okay. So the question is, Brother Muhammad Rahman, can I read Ayatul Kursi, Quran, without wudu? And can I make dhikr without wudu? Making dhikr without wudu is absolutely permissible. Because Allah said in Surah Al-Imran, الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ The believers, they mention Allah standing up, sitting down, and lying down. And Sayyidah Aisha said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ أَحْوَالِهِ The Prophet ﷺ used to remember Allah Azza and mention Allah Azza and do dhikr under any circumstances, whether he has wudu or not, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though he was tahir all the time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the most pure human being, the most pure creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for reciting the Quran, I'm not going to mention the different opinions, but it's disliked, or it's not one of the etiquettes of reading the Quran to read Quran without wudu, if you can have wudu. But if it's difficult, like I'm outside, for example, at work, or I'm driving in the car and I don't have wudu in this case, but I want to recite some Quran, Ayat al-Kursi, or some other Quran, you can follow the opinion of Ibn Taymiyyah and Al-Zahiriyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah and Al-Zahiriyyah and some Hanbali scholars, they said you can't recite Quran without wudu. But the etiquettes of reciting Quran is wudu and use miswak, face the qibla, and be clean and then start reciting. There's a difference between the etiquettes and what it's obligatory to do. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khayran. See you tomorrow inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.